Welcome to Wisdom for Life. This is part of our series on the virtual workplace. I'm here with David Hepworth from Aviva. Hi, David. David is lead creative in learning for Aviva in the UK. And we're sort of talking about the virtual workplace. Both we've done the immediate sort of impacts, and we're now looking at the medium term impacts as expected, or as we at the moment think is going to happen. This virtual working continues into this medium term. So, David, first of all, I guess this, you know, for a lot of us, this is still the first week, maybe the second week. When it stops being, I don't know if novelty is the right word, but when it stops being an immediate challenge we're facing, how do organisations keep the sort of momentum going as people start to think, how long is this going to continue for?
Yeah, I think that's, it's a challenging question, that one, John, isn't it? To be fair, I think, you know, lots of us are sat here now hoping and wishing that this will be over in a matter of days, if not weeks. But I think there's a practicality to be had here that, you know, it looks like this will be going on for the foreseeable. But I think if there's one thing that we probably do need to keep thinking about is that, you know, a normal service will resume at some point. So this is not a new normal. This is a moment in time that we will navigate, we'll learn lots from, and it probably will change the way the world is after this. And, you know, there'll be some legacies left behind, but there will be a return to normal at some point in the future. And I think that's so, so important that we all take a moment to keep an eye on that, because it's very easy to get kind of caught up in the kind of the depth and darkness of what's occurring, or feel like you're wrapped up in a despair bubble. But actually, you know, this is short term. But I think, you know, there are probably some practical elements to this as well. So I think, you know, what we are going to see is that, you know, as with any kind of exposure experience, folks are going to get better at this. And actually, what I would imagine we start to see or anticipate start to see in the coming weeks, months and years ahead will be, you know, a greater advocacy of engaging through virtual means and you know, maybe at more challenges. Do you really need to travel? Do you really need to go to London for that meeting, or actually kind of do something a little bit differently? So, you know, I think we are going to see some of that kind of movement, but in the immediate moment, I think it's just look keep supporting your teams and colleagues, making sure that they're aware of the tool capabilities that are available to them to stay connected and to work virtually. And you know, adapt and learn, because it's changing every day, and it will continue to. And but I think, you know, as I say, we get more and more confident with the technology and more confident in our abilities, we should start to see a level of normal service resumed, even albeit within you know, everyone seeing each other's wallpaper.
And there's a lot of wallpaper around. So with regards to, because wellbeing has been talked about within the workplace for a long time now, are there specific issues around wellbeing? Are there specific things as leaders we need to be thinking about, given this current situation might be continuing for a while?
Oh, most definitely, John. And it's more important now than it's ever been, because I think it's front of mind of our people and our colleagues and our communities. And I think it manifests in so many different ways. I mean, you've got your obvious kind of standouts, which is look after your own well-being, make sure you're hydrated, make sure you're getting enough sleep, make sure you're eating well, getting some exercise, because you're going to need that for your immune system. So I think, you know, you strip that down to its pure basics, you've got to kind of be thinking about that just to get through the days. There is an element of mental well-being as well, and let's not lose sight of how being in a quarantined environment can actually make you feel quite, you know, the word isolation is being used, and it's quite a negatively loaded word. So I'm making an effort to try and use the word quarantine whenever I can, as opposed to isolation. In the same way, using words like physical distancing as opposed to social distancing, because we still want people to talk, we still want people to have social interactions. It's just going to be through machines as opposed to hugging and high-fiving in the park. So, but we do need to be thinking about, you know, people's well-being mentally at this moment in time. And so, you know, whether that's adopting things like mindfulness and practice some meditation, or, you know, leaning on support networks and people around you to kind of, you know, be talking about these things. And I think that's kind of really important as well. the biggest risk I think most of us are going to face is the desire to overwork. So, you know, I talk a lot about kind of presenteeism is the cancer of any organization. It really kind of causes some of the worst behaviors in people and leaders if we're not careful. And the temptation to be readily available all the time, answering every email at any time of the day is going to be strong, especially as more and more people are working with flexible hours as they kind of navigate all these kind of murky moments. I think there's probably five pieces of advice I'd give if I was to summarize well-being, and that would be, look, understand where to get support. So, you know, hopefully your organization has support networks available, whether that's through communities or third-party providers. At the very worst case scenario, obviously you've got the amazing NHS with all of their resources at your disposal. So, you know, don't suffer in silence. If you're feeling fragile, you're feeling, you know, a bit rough, call it out. People, you're not alone, and people will help you. As I've said, eat and sleep well. That's so, so important. You know, I don't mind sharing. I suffer with a chronic condition. I've suffered isolation for long periods of time. 20 weeks was the maximum period I was isolated before. It's hard going. It is tough going. So eating, sleeping well, establishing routines and schedules, all of those things will help you. You know, get up, get dressed for the day. You know, go for a walk in the morning if you can, but, you know, take the dog out, do whatever it is that keeps you kind of in a pattern of some form. It will help you. It will help you navigate those moments, and it'll stop those bad habits emerging. No one wants to do a Skype call in the pajamas. And then the last two elements, I think, really would be, look, make time for you. You know, this is, and that links into that presenteeism piece, which is, you know, even if you've got holidays booked, you know, yeah, you might not be able to go to your wonderful trip to Tunisia now or wherever it is that you were going, but a stay vacation is equally important. You know, downtime, spending time with family, just, you know, resting away from the noise of the universe is going to stand you in great stead. So, you know, ultimately, just be kind to yourself. Know when you're struggling, and don't be shy at taking a break. Everyone's running at a slower pace than expected now. So, you know, recognize that.
And when you talk about presenteeism, and you were talking in a previous discussion we had about showing gratitude, I guess as this goes on, assuming this goes on, people are going to be more aware of getting recognition or giving reward and gratitude and thanks. Is that something that we can start to think about now and build into, I don't know, our processes, maybe even our structures?
Absolutely, John. And I think it's probably more important now than ever to be thinking about how am I going to recognise and reward the performance of my team, and even encouraging that conversation within your team. How are you going to recognise and celebrate performance, you know, cross-peer? You know, hopefully most organizations will have some kind of mechanism for that in place already. But, you know, even if it's just a simple thank you, you know, it goes a really long way. I think the biggest challenge leaders are going to face is, especially moving to a virtual sense, is that temptation to be a micromanager and being comfortable knowing that you can't sit on shoulders. You're going to have to trust your team. And actually, I think that's a really exciting moment. It means that individuals are going to have to step up. Those moments to shine will be even brighter than before. So as a leader myself, you know, my ask of anybody else in that situation is to just focus on goals and outcomes. What was it that you needed to arrive at, and did you arrive there? And then, you know, through the coaching conversations you have with your team and the daily interactions, you'll hear the stories and the moments just by the sheer nature of them, by being curious and asking how you got there and how it felt and what went well. All of those kind of rich moments of great discovery or brave decisions will shine brightly. And it's on you as a leader to jump on those and celebrate them and share them as far and wide so that others can use those as exemplars to kind of stand behind and follow. Which is one of the things we're doing in Aviva at the moment. We're proactively seeking as many stories as possible of those moments to share widely with others so that we can kind of really highlight, you know, where are those bright stars who are going above and beyond and recognise them in the moment.
That seems to me a really interesting thing for a leader, because there is, I guess, the tendency to either be too hands-off or too micromanaging. how do you help leaders strike that balance? That's a really tricky thing to do, I guess, when you're not seeing people face to face.
It's a challenge, but I think, you know, as a leader, we probably need to be thinking about this with kind of four lenses. So, you know, this is about how you keep things running. So first and foremost, manage expectations. You know, expectations need to be different now. You know, I might have childcare challenges, I might have internet connection issues, I might have hardware issues. And all of these things are going to change the level of pace and arguably quality of what it is that I would normally do. So, you know, I think those expectations need to be recontracted. And that's on an individual basis with a leader in their team. You know, every case is different. You know, you might have someone living at home with a vulnerable person, for example. So, you know, their attention has to be somewhere else. And, you know, so I think there's a bit of flexibility there that we just need to re-baseline. What are we expecting from people? And I think within that space is prioritization. So, you know, what was important last week is not important now. Yeah, we've got to adjust and we've got to rethink and actually cut our cloth accordingly based on the challenges that we have at hand. So, you know, again, being prepared to let go of some things and being open and honest and keeping that dialogue with your team will really help in that space. And it will allow your team to have clarity on this is what I need to do. And I don't have to worry about all this other stuff because actually it's not important right now. And within that, you might want to then think about your goal setting. So what goals, you know, we all start the year with full of gusto and ready to go. And this is going to be the year I make a dent in the universe and all that good stuff. But, you know, six weeks ago, no one thought this was going to happen. And we're here now. And so those goals may need to be tempered. And so I think, you know, again, back to that exchange in expectations and just rethinking it, maybe not be a not ever, but it's probably not a not now. And so, you know, by having those conversations and being ready to flex with your teams will, I think, serve that bit well and allow you to concentrate on the outcomes and the goals being realized. And then lastly, I think it's also about staying true to your team and reassuring them that a normal state will resume. There will be a new normal. We will get through this. It's not going to be like this forever. You know, we're not all kind of caged animals now. You know, we will get through this. We'll play out. And before you know it, we're all being on towers. So I think, you know, it's just a case of taking it and keeping the conversation going with your team and reassuring them with the latest information and the latest updates with what's occurred.
And I guess as well as recalibrating our goals and recalibrating our expectations, if you look at this with those rose-tinted spectacles on, as well as the sort of creative opportunities, with us coming from a learning background, it's also a potential to learn new skills and learn new ways of working.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that's, if there's one, I'm hesitant to say win, because I don't think there is a win in any of this, but there is a residue of all of this, probably the best way to describe it, which is, you know, we've got, like many organizations, I'm sure, we've got large swathes of people right now who want to come to work but can't, or don't have the facilities or means typically to engage with networks and tasks and actions that they get paid to do. But what they can do is enrich that space and time with kind of what we get out of bed for every morning, John, you know, which is to help people be the best versions of themselves that they can be and dream big about their careers. And I'm sure, like many of our listeners today, time is the most common cited barrier that I hear when someone says, I can't do learning. Okay, well, that excuse is off the table right now. Time is something we have lots of. So I think, you know, it's about, you know, again, being creative with your teams or as individuals and just asking yourself those questions, you know, what access can I engage with? And even if, you know, the organization I work with, you know, can't provide me access to resources or portals that might benefit me, you know, even if it's just working through YouTube, there's a richness of material out there now, you know. So I think there's one ask there of everybody. It's to be thinking about your development goals now and actually, you know, and you can split this really easily in two levels. One is, you know, there's an immediate need here to be good at technology. So let's go get doing that. And then beyond that, you know, let's be thinking about, well, you know, what do I want to be when I grow up? What potential capabilities might I need in the near future? Because I've got the luxury of space and time to be doing that now. So make hay while the sun shines, as my granddad once said.
That's great. Thanks, David. So that's sort of what we're looking at in the medium term. In our next discussion, we're going to look at the future of the workplace, given all these changes that we've currently gone through. But for now, that's great. Thanks, David.
Thank you very much, John.